In the wake of a worldwide surge in grain prices 2 years ago, securing stable food supply is a serious challenge for many countries. Foreign firms are snapping up farmland in Africa. Here's a look at the case in Ethiopia.
Rays of light are moving around in the darkness. They come from large tractors working on farmland. Foreign companies are scrambling to obtain farmland in Africa. This Indian company is the world's largest producer of roses. It decided to do business in Africa in order to take advantage of a rise in worldwide demand for grains.
Well, they say it takes at least 5 months to cultivate such a vast land here.
The company purchased farmland in Ethiopia in 2008. It plans to grow and export maize and other grains. Hanuman Rao is an Indian supervisor of agricultural land.
That side, right side you are seeing.
You can see a belt of green trees over there. That marks the limit of our farmland.
That is our north side border.
The plot measures around 300,000 hectares, roughly 1.5 times the size of Tokyo. The land is worth just $10 a hectare. The company signed a 50-year lease with the Ethiopian government with assistance from the Indian government.
Land as wide as this is available only in Africa. This continent offers many opportunities.
Also for growing various crops.
The Ethiopian government is welcoming foreign firms seeking farmland.
Indian company are now in Gambela. Mm-hmm. Also, the Saudi Star, which is found 11,000 hectares of land in Gambela. Chinese investors are on process to have the land in Benshangul area.
So far, companies from five countries have started or decided to start operations in Ethiopia. Behind the government's plan lies a serious food shortage continuing to plague Ethiopia. Ethiopians are practicing traditional farming methods using livestock. Therefore, they are currently using only 16% of the country's arable land. The government is depending on foreign investment to modernize agriculture and increase the grain harvest.
Investors are coming, there will be technology, there will be capital stock, there will be job opportunity, there will be skill, there will be the contribution for our economy. Therefore, it is important for the country.
Meanwhile, it's not all good news. Major agricultural investment in Africa by foreign businesses is raising concerns. The UN Food and Agriculture Organization warns that it could lead to a new wave of colonialism. NHK World's Kohei Tsuji has more on the situation in Tanzania.
This is the village of Namawala in central Tanzania. Residents were stunned last summer when authorities ordered most of them to hand over their land. The companies from the Middle East and other regions attempted to acquire about 10,000 hectares of the village land. Zuberi Hemed is the head of the village. He says local government officials came to their village last August and forced them out.
The officials ordered us to leave even before we decided where to go. After all, there is nowhere else. All the villagers can live together. We raise our children and lead a life on this land. We cannot earn a living in a different location.
Empty homes and abandoned farmlands have become conspicuous in the village since the authorities banned agriculture.
Families in this home and that one have already left the village.
Villagers had no choice but to suspend the construction of an elementary school. About 200 children were deprived of school education. Hemed held a rally with residents to protest the government move.
If foreign firms obtain our land, we won't be able to get food, feed our families, or allow children to go to school.
What lies behind this problem? In many African nations, residents do not have the right to own land. In Tanzania, land is the property of the government. Residents are only allowed to use land. The authorities say the villagers of Namawala do not even have the right to use the land.
But all of a sudden now, people have shown a very big interest in that particular land. And the villagers, for instance, they have seen it as now as an opportunity to get some money.
Hemet and his villagers filed a complaint with the court over the ownership of the land. However, the authorities are boycotting the court sessions.
Government officials came to us without advance notice and seized our land. Their action is nowhere near legal. We want to protect our land and the future of our land.
Joining us in the studio is Kohei Tsuji, who filed this report. Thanks for coming in. The situation looks very complex. First off, will foreign investment, when they bring their money in, will that resolve such things as poverty and starvation in Africa?
It really depends. In the case of Indian company featured in the report, well, the land lease doesn't really impose limits on where those farms can sell the crops, and which means that the farm can sell all those crops outside the country if they wanted to, even if the famine occurs there. And at the same time, however, African countries want to get out of poverty by welcoming those investors and boosting agricultural productivity. And they hope that the foreign investment will bring modern agricultural technology and improve local infrastructure.
There seems to be more immediate problems like forcible eviction, and that seems to continue, as we've seen in your report. Will that trigger social unrest, and if so, how can it be prevented?
Right. In March last year, a row over foreign acquisition of farmland in Madagascar toppled the country's government. And the people were infuriated by reports that their government had struck a deal with a South Korean company to lease farmland free of charge for 99 years. And it resulted in the military forcing president to step down. Well, this incident shows how sensitive the issue of foreign acquisition of farmland could be. And that's why the clear set of rules must be formulated. And 31 nations have agreed last September and to meet in New York to work on the set of rules to govern the international transactions of farmland. The regulations are expected to incorporate the rights of local residents. But even if rules are set, there is no legal framework to enforce compliance. And some have already questioned whether international regulations can make a difference.
Well, I guess once again we get back to that question, securing stable grain prices and reliable food supply. It's going to be a serious challenge, not for all these developing countries like Africa, but for industrialized nations as well. Thank you very much for coming in. Kohei Tsuji of NHK World.